In recent months, I've posted several videos on banking in classical Athens, that's 4th century BCE. The core business activities of classic commercial banks, borrowing, i.e. accepting deposits, and lending, followed much the same commercial and legal principles as they do today. Now, it's a fact of life that banks left to their own devices fail from time to time, and we'd expect to see much the same for classical Athenian banks. So with everything going on in the world of finance right now, I thought I'd take some time to survey what we know about bank failures in classical Athens. Welcome to Ancient Classics. There's scattered evidence amongst the speeches of Demosthenes of bank failures, and there should be absolutely nothing remarkable about that per se. In Demosthenes' speech number 36 for Phormion, we see the most references to bank failures, even though the speech itself has little to do with bank failure per se. Demosthenes 36 is a really important speech, and it has a lot to say about how banks were organized and run in classical Athens, but we'll save that for another time. The key point for our purposes is this. Demosthenes' client, Phormion, was a former slave. His former and deceased master, Passion, himself was an ex-slave and also one of the leading bankers, if not the leading banker of the time. Passion appointed Phormion to run the bank under a lease, and Phormion ran the bank for many years, successfully too, it seems, because the bank remained in business whilst several other banks failed. Oh, and Phormion also married Passion's widow. That's just how corporate transactions were structured back then. Later, one of Passion's sons, Apollodorus, sued Phormion for payment of a loan supposedly made by Passion to Phormion. Demosthenes' speech 36 is Phormion's defense, or technically counterclaim. It's given on behalf of Phormion, who was unable to deliver the speech in person. But anyway, the speaker is at this point in the speech describing how successfully Phormion ran the business. Look at Sozinomus and Timodemus and the other bankers who, when they had to discharge their debts to their creditors, had to give up all their possessions. But you don't even think it's necessary to consider the steps your father, a much better man, planned to take to prepare for all such matters. Now, Passion, by Zeus and the gods, considered Phormion to be so much more worthy than you. And for his, your, and the business's sake, he left the business and his wife to Phormion, even though you were of age. Indeed, so long as he lived, Passion highly esteemed Phormion. Rightly so too, my fellow Athenians. For other bankers, even those who owned their businesses outright and didn't have to pay any rent, all went bust, whereas Phormion, paying a rent of 2 talents and 40 minae, kept the bank going for you. So it seems, if anecdotally, that several banks failed during that period, sometime in the first half of the 4th century BCE. Though we've got to be careful not to make too much of it, as indeed some have. Edward Cohen criticizes Bogert, who tried to extrapolate from that passage that there was some kind of systemic banking crisis, possibly even two separate crises, in the 370s BCE, supposedly stemming from widespread commercial malaise in the period of decline between the end of the Peloponnesian War and the rise of Macedon. I've not managed to get down to my local classics library to check Bogert's analysis out itself, but Cohen's pretty dismissive, and frankly, if, as Cohen claims, the only evidence for a systemic banking collapse is this passage, well, my instinct is to agree. There's supposed evidence for another systemic banking crisis in the 4th century, though the date is unclear. If you've watched my video on deposit taking, you might remember the Apostheldemos scandal. That was when some treasurers of Athene fraudulently deposited the treasury's cash with some bankers. The bankers didn't pay them back and the fraud was revealed, prompting the treasurers to try to hide the evidence by burning down the treasury and temple of Athene. Well, for that to have precipitated such a crisis, presumably several banks must have gone down simultaneously or near simultaneously. But really, the details are so sketchy that one can hardly infer a full-scale banking crisis from that. But when banks did fail, for whatever reason, how did they fail? How were their failures managed? See, for some of us at least, the most interesting thing is not so much when and why banks fail, but how their failures are managed, the measures by which banks are wound up or rescued from failure altogether, bailed out or bailed in and resolved. Some of us, you see, spend most of our working lives thinking through these kind of things. Now, what would we expect to see? The ways in which modern bank failures are managed or averted are very much a recent thing. The modern resolution regime only dates as far back as the global financial crisis of the late noughties. Other tools go back to the Great Depression era and all that, and I think the basic tenets of central bank policy only go back as far as the 19th century or so. I'm not too sure. I have a fairly okay idea about 4th century and late 20th and 21st century bank reg. The rest's a bit of a blur to me. So we're left with basic insolvency processes, whereby someone, an officer or authority, takes control of a failed business, liquidates the assets, i.e. in the case of a bank, calls in the loans it has made, and uses the proceeds to pay off the creditors of the bank, depositors and other finance providers. Though the evidence is incredibly scant, we can kind of see hints of that in the classical sources. Our most detailed and insightful description comes from Demosthenes' speech 33. In this speech, Demosthenes' client is making a counterclaim against a certain Apaturius. The passage that we'll consider discusses dealings between client Apaturius and some guy, an exile from Byzantium, Parmenon, and also the bank of Heraclides. Apaturius had borrowed 40 minae, and he'd used that money to acquire a ship and some slaves, which were then docked in Athens, i.e. at the Piraeus. The lenders had called in the 40 minae loan and were threatening Apaturius for repayment. Apaturius couldn't afford to repay the loan at that time, and he didn't want to have to sell the ship and slaves. So he did what people generally do in these circumstances. He arranged a refinancing. Demosthenes' client helped him do that. 30 minae of the loan was refinanced by Heraclides' bank. So Heraclides would have loaned 30 minae to Apaturius, and Apaturius would have used that money to pay off 30 of his outstanding loan to his creditors. Well, in practice, Heraclides would probably just have paid directly. Either way, Apaturius is left owing 30 minae to Heraclides, but he still owes his old creditors 10 minae. Like I say, the refinancing deal was arranged by Demosthenes' client, who also personally guaranteed Apaturius' repayment obligations to Heraclides' bank. That's a very common arrangement today too. The Greek term here, by the way, is to act as an engue. But still, remember that Apaturius still owes 10 minae to his former creditors. So Parmenon agrees to refinance the 10 minae and pays 3 of the 10. But then Apaturius and Parmenon fall out. The details are unclear, but eventually Parmenon realizes that he just has to fund the full amount. He doesn't trust Apaturius. Demosthenes' client agrees to intercede. So it seems that Parmenon assigned his right to receive payment for the 3 minae that he'd already loaned to Demosthenes' client, presumably for deferred consideration. I.e. Demosthenes' client would have paid for taking the benefit of the loan once he'd been paid by Apaturius. And then Parmenon loaned the remaining 7 minae to Demosthenes' client, who onloaned it to Apaturius. So anyway, we're left in the situation where Apaturius has borrowed 40 minae, 30 from Heraclides' bank and 10 from Demosthenes' client. Demosthenes' client, in turn, owned Parmenon 10 minae and was the guarantor of Apaturius' obligations to repay 30 to Heraclides' bank. So basically, if Apaturius doesn't pay up, then Demosthenes' client is left having to pay 40, which is not great for him. Apaturius then grants security over the slaves and the ship in favour of the two lenders. We covered secured lending in an earlier video. What this means is that if Apaturius had failed to repay the loans, then the lenders could take possession of the ships and slaves, sell them, and use the sale proceeds to pay off what was owing to them. Okay, here's where things get really interesting. At this point, for some unknown reason, Heraclides' bank goes bust. Not long after this, the bank failed, and Heraclides went into hiding. Apaturius schemed to send the slaves from Athens and to take the ship out of harbour. That was the initial cause of my dispute with him. For Parmenon found out and seized the slaves as they were being taken away, and then he prevented the ship from setting sail. Then Parmenon sent for me and told me what had happened. When I heard about this, I thought that Apaturius was acting like a total dick, and I tried to work out how I might get released from my guarantee to the bank, and how Parmenon might avoid losing the money that he had loaned to Apaturius through me. After stationing men to guard the ship, I told the whole story to the liquidators of the bank, and turned the security over to them, telling them that Parmenon had invested 10 minae too in the ship. Having arranged this, I pledged the slaves, so that in the event of any shortfall, the deficiency might be made up by the proceeds of their sale. So what's happening here? Some amount of guesswork is required, but I reckon this is what's going on. Heraclides' bank had gone bust. The word used, by the way, is anaskuasthesis. That's connected with the word for equipment, baggage, gear, or stuff. According to my little Lidl, the term anaskuadzor means to pack up one's bags or apparently dismantle a camp in the case of an army. So really, it just means to pack up shop. Heraclides goes into hiding, we're told. Well, presumably, since his business has gone bust, he has lots of disgruntled creditors, depositors and the like, who will want to get repaid one way or the other by whatever means. They might want to vent their frustrations or take revenge. So Heraclides is probably actually in quite some personal danger. Now, in the modern age, when a person's business fails like this, one would expect several things to happen. First, any secured creditors would take immediate steps to enforce their security, i.e. take control of specific assets over which they have security, sell them and pay off the debts owed to them. And meanwhile, the failed business would enter into formal insolvency. That's where an officer or officers are appointed to take control of the business, collecting the assets, those at least which haven't in the meantime been snaffled by secured creditors, and distribute them in some kind of orderly manner to the failed business's creditors. We sort of see that happening. See, Arbuturius tries to sail away with the ship and slaves, but Parmenon tries to stop him. Hold on, what's this got to do with Heraclides' failed bank, you might say? I mean, Arbuturius borrowed the money from Heraclides and presumably doesn't have to pay it back yet. And the ship and slaves belong to Arbuturius, albeit subject to a security interest in favour of the lenders. Well, I'm guessing that for some reason or other, Heraclides' liquidators, will come onto them soon, had accelerated or were planning to accelerate Arbuturius' loan, i.e., we're going to force him to repay the loan early. They might have been permitted to do that under the terms of the loan contract. We just don't know. That way, they could have used the repayment proceeds to pay off some or all of Heraclides' angry creditors, the ones he's hiding from. But if that had happened, then Arbuturius would have been unable to pay. Because remember, he'd been unable to pay his old creditors in the first place, which is why he needed to refinance the loans. So if Arbuturius had been forced to repay the loan early, he would have defaulted and the bank's liquidators would have enforced the security over the ship and slaves, forcibly selling them and then using the proceeds to pay off the bank's creditors. So Arbuturius tried to do a runner with the ship and slaves, but Parmenon stopped him. Now, Demosthenes' client is caught in the middle here, because remember, he's guaranteed Arbuturius' loan to Heraclides' bank, and he's also on the hook for repaying the loan to Parmenon. So if Arbuturius had done a runner with the ships and slaves, then the liquidators of the bank would have forced Demosthenes' client to pay instead, and Demosthenes' client would still need to find a way to pay Parmenon. Not a great situation to be in. So Parmenon was doing a favour by foiling Arbuturius' plan to escape with the ship and slaves. Meanwhile, Demosthenes' client is really worried about being on the hook as guarantor, so he's trying to work out how to release himself. He comes up with a pretty good plan. He takes control of the ship by hiring a bunch of heavies to guard it, then somehow pledges the ships and slaves to the liquidators. That's a bit confusing, because you'd expect the liquidators of the failed bank would have automatically taken on the security interest over the ship and slaves, because they're effectively acting on behalf of the bank. But who knows? We just don't know enough about the details of ancient Athenian insolvency law or the underlying contractual arrangements here. Regardless of the legal position, the bank's liquidators still had a practical problem. If the ships and slaves went missing, then any legal security interests would have been pretty useless anyway. So Demosthenes' client and Parmenon did them a solid favour by making sure that that didn't happen. Perhaps also Demosthenes' client also released or subordinated his own security interests as lender so that the bank liquidators wouldn't have to worry about Demosthenes' client taking his part of the sale proceeds before the bank loan had been fully paid. That would have put Demosthenes' client in a position of increased vulnerability vis-a-vis the 10 minae that he was owed and which he in turn owed to Parmenon. But perhaps he took a view that it was worth losing as a price for being released from his guarantee of 30 minae. I don't know, I'm guessing. But still, the big picture is relatively clear here. Now, I've been talking about these so-called liquidators of the bank, assuming that they act much like the insolvency officers of a failed business today. But I've only really just used that label as a term of convenience thus far. They're actually described as the Anguetai, guarantors of the bank, just like Demosthenes is the guarantor of Apaturius. So if we're to take that literally, this means that those guys were more than just liquidators, persons appointed or self-appointed to make sure that Heraclides' assets were collected in and used to pay off the creditors. Rather, they were somehow legally liable to pay Heraclides' debt themselves. Well, if so, how did they find themselves in that position as guarantors of Heraclides and the bank? Possibly they agreed to it as part of some entirely separate commercial deal of which we're not aware, but perhaps they were performing some kind of official quasi-governmental function. Perhaps these liquidators or guarantors were specially appointed officers whose job or legal duty was to ensure that the creditors of failed banks got paid. Something like a modern-day deposit guarantee scheme, or even a resolution authority. Frankly, that strikes me as a little far-fetched. Those kind of functions are very much a modern invention, though this hasn't stopped some people from theorizing. Bogert seems to think that there were, or there might have existed, a system whereby individuals were mandated by the state to act as guarantors of a failed bank's obligation and insolvency. Cohen is just as dismissive of Bogert's theory here as he is of Bogert's view that there was some kind of systemic 4th century banking collapse. It seems that Bogert had zero evidence for this, and save for this passing reference in Demosthenes 33, he was just extrapolating from later medieval practices. So, back to Demosthenes' client and what happened next. So when I grasped the fact that Apaturius had wronged us, I made things right for me and Parmenon. But Apaturius, as if I was the one in the wrong, blamed me and asked if it was not enough for me to be released from my guarantee to the bank without also pledging the ship and the slaves to secure his money from Parmenon, thus making an enemy of him for the sake of the foreign exile Parmenon. I replied that Parmenon had put his trust in me, and so I was not minded to mess him around, because even though he was an exile, he'd had a bad time of it, and he was being wronged by Apaturius. And after I'd done everything possible and had incurred his utmost enmity, I with difficulty secured the money, and the ship was sold for 40 minae, the precise amount for which he was mortgaged. 30 minae were paid back to the bank, and 10 minae to Parmenon before many witnesses. We cancelled the loan in accordance with which the money had been lent, and mutually released and discharged one another from our engagements, so that the plaintiff had nothing more to do with me, nor I with him. So from that, it would seem that Demosthenes' client and Parmenon had sorted everything out. But of course, it didn't end there, because Apaturius now had beef with Demosthenes' client, leading to the ensuing litigation. Luckily for us, because that's why we have this text. Well, that was a rather long digression, perhaps, but assuming we can take the facts presented to us as reliable, it was, after all, just one side story in a court case, it demonstrates to us how a bank insolvency might actually have worked in practice, and how other parties might have been embroiled therein. It's pretty fascinating, if anything, because it's really not too dissimilar to what we might see today if we were to just strip away the modern functions of central banks, deposit guarantee schemes, and resolution authorities and all that. So let's wrap up. Failure is a recurrent fact of life in any business sector. And so it is no surprise that banks in classical Athens failed from time to time. Given the fact that banks in classical Athens performed much the same commercial and legal functions as more modern commercial banks, they borrowed money, took deposits, and loaned money, sometimes on a secured basis. So it follows that ancient banks were vulnerable to much the same risks as their modern equivalents, principally the risks that the debtors would default or fail to pay back their loans, and that then the banks would in turn be unable to repay their creditors and depositors and the like when due, or more to the point that their creditors may have been afraid that that was going to happen, which would have prompted a bank run. But Demosthenes' speech 33 also illustrates the active role played by the parties, whether liquidators, contractual guarantors, or even sort of proto-resolution officers, in seeking to collect in and distribute in some kind of organized manner a failed bank's assets. And whilst none of that is necessarily too surprising of itself, beyond Demosthenes 33, it is barely discussed in the primary literature. When banks failed, well, sure, creditors would have lost out, and others would have got caught up in the mess. And that would have been very unfortunate for those thus affected. But the chances are that banks were not into interconnected enough or sufficiently systemically important to make this too much of a big deal across society or the economy as a whole, just part of the ups and downs of business and life. So, whilst the financial tools and legal functions of classical Athenian banks may have been much the same as their present-day counterparts, their economic significance was of a very different order, which is what ultimately the likes of Millet have been saying since way back when. Classical Athenian banks were, indeed you could say, small enough to fail. I've kind of rushed this video out, partly in response to everything going on in the world of finance right now. Next time, we'll return to Poetry and Myth, a Latin poem this time, but one too with especially contemporary resonance. Until then, like and subscribe, and we'll be back soon.